Right, good evening everybody. My name is Kirsty Owen. I'm in Historic Environment Scotland's Archaeology and World Heritage team, and I'd like to welcome you to Longmore House and to the Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology, which is a year-long celebration of Scotland's history, heritage and archaeology. This is one of the first events that Historic Environment Scotland are actually doing, and I think, certainly in my time, the first time that we've ever let the general public into Longmore House. So I hope you enjoy yourself, and I hope you're all very pleased to be here. We're certainly very pleased to have you. So in the first instance, I'd like to introduce you to our Chief Executive, Alex Patterson, who's going to tell you a little bit more about what we've got in store over the course of this year and about what you're going to hear this evening. Thank you very much.
Good. Thank you, Kirsty. Good evening, and let me just reiterate Kirsty's welcome to you. Welcome to Longmore House. We haven't let the general public in before. I hope you're not too disappointed. I remember you're very impressed, but appropriate enough for an organisation such as us. We are in an old building, which has its challenges as well as its upsides as well. But you're very welcome, and we're delighted to have you with us tonight. There are a few empty seats. This is a sellout, so hopefully other people will join. And sold out within a matter of days, so I think it's a reflection of just the interest there is in history, heritage and archaeology, but maybe in this particular subject. And the good news is that this is the first of 12 of these lectures, and if you have the chance just to look at this pop-up later on, you'll see at the bottom the themes for the full year. They'll be on our website within the next few days as well, but each one takes a theme of the age of, going from stone today right up to this age, which will be the theme for December. So you'll have the dates and the themes on the website soon, so mark them in your diary, and we'd love to see you along at future ones as well. And I've only been with this organisation for 4 months, and so within the room I'm probably the least knowledgeable, so it's probably appropriate that I've come to learn as much as I can from our speakers this evening. But one of the things that struck me in joining this organisation is just how much knowledge and expertise we have within Historic Environment Scotland. So it was a good idea when the suggestion came that why don't we organise a lecture series, and our own staff who live and work and breathe and eat and sleep this stuff have a chance to share their expertise with you. And that's really what this lecture tonight and those over the balance of the year are designed to do, to give you a bit of an insight into the expertise and knowledge of our staff, what gives them the passion for what they do, and also a bit of an insight into what they do day in, day out as part of the team here at Historic Environment Scotland. And all of this is set within the context of the Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology. And you probably have to have been in the moon for the last number of weeks not to have picked up that this is one of the government's themed years, History, Heritage and Archaeology, and we will be announcing a more extensive programme of activities very soon. But it's one of these themed years that's sort of got our name on it. You know, it's what we do as History, Heritage and Archaeology, but we're trying to do a number of additional things this year, so look out for some interesting things coming over the next wee while. Tonight's speakers will focus on the theme of Neolithic or New Stone Age, and I'm looking at my notes here, which says this dates from 4300 BC to 2500 BC. So we're going back a fair amount of time. And we have two speakers for you this evening, Dr. Anne MacSween and Dr. Kirsty Millican, who know what they're talking about in this area. And I, like you, am looking forward to hearing what they have to say to us. Let me just tell you a wee bit about them. Anne studied prehistoric archaeology at the University of Edinburgh and archaeological sciences at the University of Bradford, where she undertook her research for her PhD on Neolithic pottery from Orkney. She has worked at the University of Dundee as an archaeologist in the private sector, and for the last 17 years has worked for Historic Environment Scotland or its predecessors, and she now heads up one of the casework teams within our heritage directorate. She describes herself as a heritage manager by day and antiquarian by night. Her research interests are wide-ranging, including prehistoric pottery, brochs, battlefield memorials, and tonight's subject, the Neolithic of Orkney. And then after Anne has spoken to us, Dr. Kirsty Millican will be speaking to us a wee bit about Kirsty. Became an archaeologist, or decided to become an archaeologist at the age of 8, which is a fairly early stage to have formed your career aspirations. Going on to gain an honours, master's and a PhD in archaeology, all from the University of Glasgow. And since completing a PhD on the Neolithic timber monuments of Scotland in 2009, Kirsty has had a temporary lectureship at Aberdeen University and worked in historic land use assessment projects for the Royal Commission of the Ancient Historic Monuments of Scotland, one of the organisations that merged with Historic Scotland to form Historic Environment Scotland. She was appointed a designations officer within this organisation in September 15, and it also maintains a research affiliate with Glasgow University's Archaeology Department, and her research interests include Neolithic and Early Bronze Scotland, crop mark and landscape archaeology, and is published on aspects of Neolithic timber and landscapes. So I think we've got two people well qualified to talk to us tonight on the whole theme of Neolithic or the new Stone Age. Let me invite Anne to come and speak to us first. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that introduction. Kirsty and I are really pleased to be with you this evening to give the first talk in the Historic Environment Scotland Age Of series. Given the time available, we're going to give a brief introduction to the Neolithic of Scotland and also talk a little about how we think that early farming communities expressed their identity through their buildings and their way of life. As Alec was saying in his introduction, I work in the casework team of the Heritage Directorate and Kirsty works in designations. So our talks will reflect some aspects of our jobs and also our own research interests. And we hope you'll stay on afterwards when we'll be pleased to answer any of your questions. When we talk about the Neolithic, what are we talking about? What archaeologists term Neolithic, or New Stone Age, is the period between roughly 4000 BC and 2500 BC, so starting about 6000 years ago. The people living on the land that we now call Scotland would not, of course, have thought of themselves as Neolithic. To them, it was their present, their here and now, their day to day. Archaeologists, like historians, label and divide time, organise the past. Neolithic expert Professor Julian Thomas from Manchester University has noted that it is the experience of something mysterious and alien which first inspires many of us to take up archaeology as a study. Yet it is precisely through attempting to find out more about the past that we erode its unfamiliarity. We introduce techniques of classification and rationalisation which homogenise and tame the past. So we construct frameworks and decide what points of change are the defining ones. And we have decided that one of these defining points of change is the Neolithic, the time during which farming became established over much of Scotland, although the procurement of food by fishing, hunting and gathering still carried on, and in some cases continued to be the primary food source throughout. A major change for society in the Neolithic was that farming communities became based in one place. Along with farming comes the need for fields, cleared areas for planting, and fences to keep animals away from crops, the infrastructure that allows a community to generate its own food supply. While communities basing their food procurement on hunting and gathering would have had their own territories, it is likely that with farming, the concept of stewardship, if not ownership, of land emerged with all that brings in terms of the need to mark and maintain boundaries, both in a physical and a conceptual way. And so this evening, we'll look at how these early farming communities lived, how we as archaeologists piece together interpretations of their lives from the material remains that they left. We will look at the difference in the archaeology of the Neolithic communities in Orkney and in the south of Scotland. We'll talk about some of Scotland's best known archaeological sites, but we'll also talk of some that will be less familiar to many of you. And we'll end by telling you about how you can find out more. I'm going to start with Orkney and Scarabray, which is the place that many archaeologists would think of if they were asked to name a Neolithic settlement site. Scarabray was exposed by a storm in 1850 and excavated in the late 1920s by Vere Gordon Child. It is now managed by Historic Environment Scotland, and this is a good place to acknowledge the great work of our colleagues around the country on the conservation teams and visitor services who do so much to ensure that the sites are in good condition and ready for the thousands of people who visit both staffed and unstaffed sites every year. Anyway, back to Scarabray. The reason that I enjoy visiting is that there are many things about the buildings and their contents that are familiar. It's easy to imagine families living there, insulated from the worst of the weather by the design of their houses, small circular buildings grouped together, linked by passageways and surrounded by earthy deposits piled up against the exterior walls. Inside, the main design features are replicated from building to building. A central hearth with kerb stones around it, box beds which would have been filled with soft material to create a comfortable base to lie on, and stone dressers where you can imagine the family's everyday possessions and maybe also heirlooms on display. As well as the careful excavation and ongoing conservation of the site as a visitor attraction, it is the building material, the thin Orkney sandstone flags, and the preservation of the site under sand that has ensured that Scarabray has survived to the present day. As we will see later when Kirsty talks about the nature of the archaeology over much of the lowlands, the visibility of sites in areas where stone was the preferred building material has led to these sites receiving much of the research focus in Scotland until relatively recently. Scarabray is part of the heart of Neolithic Orkney World Heritage Site, which is located here. On the right of this slide is the heart of Neolithic Orkney community map, produced by the pupils of Stenness Community School and other members of the local community who share their drawings and stories. The sites that make up the World Heritage Site include the Maze Howe burial site, which is on the front of the map, the Stones of Stenness Henge and Stone Circle, and the Ring of Brodgar Henge and Stone Circle. These sites add depth to what we understand of the Neolithic of Orkney by providing information about other aspects of life for the communities of these islands. So let's look at Maze Howe, a chambered tomb, a type of burial site found over much of Britain and Ireland in the Neolithic. While there are many variations across the country, the concept is similar throughout. A burial chamber, usually reached along a passage, the chamber and passage encased in a stone cairn or earth mound. Here at Maze Howe, the mound is 35 metres across and 7 metres high. The design of the tombs varies from area to area. Sometimes they have several chambers, as you can see here inside Maze Howe. So this is the chamber inside and the little antechambers around. Notice here is at Scarabray the quality of the dry stone building, the product of expert builders who were well used to working in the local building materials. The passage and chambers were constructed of stone slabs, some of considerable weight. The builders understood the way that their materials could be used to create the structure that they needed. To form the roof, they overlapped each course slightly to narrow the structure until the chamber could be covered by a capstone. The tomb was designed to be closed, perhaps between burials, and you can see the jambs of the door 2 metres from the entrance passage. While many tombs share the same basic design principles, their details differed. Here is the chamber of the cairn at Coyness and Sandy, where you can see that the design is taller and narrower, standing to height of around 4 metres. The cairn itself insulated and waterproofed the passage and the chamber, but as well as this, it formed a prominent feature in the landscape. These tombs are obviously a lot more than a functional way to bury the dead. They were carefully positioned, using the topography for maximum dramatic effect, marking the importance of the living as well as the dead. In Orkney, as elsewhere, chamber tombs are scattered all over the landscape, the design varying, but the concept constant. Excavations of chamber tombs can provide a lot of information for archaeologists. Study of human remains can provide information on disease and trauma, diet and age of death. Pottery and bone and stone personal items are often included in the chamber, and occasionally the burial chamber includes more unusual items. At Isbister on South Ronaldsay, a site owned and looked after by the Simonson family, 30 individuals were estimated to have been buried in the chamber. Along with the burials were the talons and bones from an estimated 14 white-tailed or sea eagles, which led to Isbister becoming known as Tomb of the Eagles. What do these represent? It has been suggested that the eagles may have been a totem or symbol of the community who used the tomb. Discoveries such as these give us a tiny glimpse into the complexities and colour of life in the Neolithic. The numbers of individuals found in the tombs indicate that the burials represent only a small proportion of the community. What was it that ensured the right to burial in a chamber cairn? Are these one family, the heads of a community, the members of the first family to settle in an area? Or did the individuals who gained the right to be buried here have some other special quality or power or circumstance? Things get even more complicated when we try to make sense of the large ceremonial monuments, the stone circles and henges. In Orkney, the two best known circles are the Ring of Brodgar and the Stones of Stenness, set at either end of the narrow isthmus between the lochs of Harre and Stenness. Each circle is set within a henge, a circular enclosure comprising a ditch and bank, the bank formed on the inside of the ditch. While the ditches look fairly shallow now, excavation at the Stones of Stenness by Graham Ritchie in the 1970s showed that the ditch was 2 metres deep and 7 metres wide, requiring the removal of around 1,250 tonnes of sandstone, which could have taken up to 50,000 hours of work. What were these monuments for? Survey work carried out and published by Alexander Thom in the 1960s concluded that many of the circles were astronomical observatories. Although many of his more detailed conclusions have been questioned, it is likely that some of the monuments, and indeed single stones like this one in Ede, the Stone of Setter, could have been used for observing the major astronomical events, such as the lunar rising and setting points, or the spring and summer equinoxes. In communities which depended on farming and fishing, it would have been important to know when to expect high tides or strong winds. It is not improbable that ceremonies involved the sun and moon and were timed to coincide with the seasonal movements across the sky. Archaeologists then used the information from individual sites to build up a picture of what life would have been like for Neolithic communities in an area. One of the difficulties in doing this is that we don't know what we still have to find, and there can be some big surprises. One of these was the recent discovery in 2002 of the site at Ness of Brodgar, a massive complex of buildings located on the thin stretch of land between the Ring of Brodgar and the Stones of Stenness. The data from geophysical survey of the World Heritage Site revealed a high concentration of anomalies in the area, which indicates buried archaeology. Excavations carried out since 2004, directed by Nick Card of the University of the Highlands and Islands, have uncovered domestic scale buildings and also buildings large enough to accommodate a gathering or meeting, which, added to the information from Stenness and Brodgar, points to this area being a focus for large scale events. The amount of pottery and bone and other items indicates that this was a venue used over many centuries, and there is much work going on with a large team of specialists to make sense of the information that the hundreds of volunteers have uncovered. So going back to my point about surprises, even in well-studied areas, really important sites can remain unnoticed for many years. In this case, right in the middle of an area visited by generations of students and researchers. Improved survey techniques are increasing the chances of identification, as is the increased availability of coverage from satellite imagery. But Scotland, while a relatively small country, is a big place to survey. And so the chances are that future generations will continue to have the thrill of discovery, and that can only be a good thing. I'd now like to tell you a little bit about my own research, my input to the story of the Neolithic in Orkney. As I was saying, when I'm not at work, I like to study prehistoric pottery, which was the subject of my doctoral research. I'm one of many specialists who, over their lifetime, build up the knowledge about a building type or artifact type or aspect of environmental analysis, and work with others to advance our understanding of one tiny piece of our prehistoric past. As a specialist, I'm very aware, though, that the study of Neolithic pottery is a bit of a niche market, and of the importance of relating the minutiae of my discoveries back into the big story. So how do we get from little bits of pottery in a plastic bag, in a box full of other bits of pottery in plastic bags, to a useful observation about the Neolithic? Let me share one of my favourite quotes with you by the potter and writer Edmund Duval from his book, The Hare with Amber Eyes. I can remember the weight and balance of a pot and how its surface works with its volume. I can read how an edge creates tension or loses it. I can feel if it has been made at speed or with diligence, if it has warmth. I can see how it works with the objects that sit nearby, how it displaces a small part of the world around it. I like this quote because it reminds us that these little bits of pottery, numbered and bagged, were once part of a vessel, made, looked after, used and disposed of by people. They're from someone's favourite pot, or most useful pot, or generous gift. They represent the learning process and expertise of the potter who made it, and who would eventually have passed that expertise on to the next generation of potters. And I would argue that you don't get much closer to a prehistoric person than a thumbprint left in clay and baked into the surface of a vessel. My basic approach to understanding and interpreting an assemblage begins with recording each shared or group of sheds in a lot of detail. What I'm trying to do is identify points of change in the sequence or possible mixing of deposits or the special selection of sheds. The identification of markers such as these depend on building up a body of data about the pottery from each layer or context of the site. I also record decoration, as it is the presence of decorated sheds that often give the biggest clue about the age of an assemblage. In recording assemblages, I'm interested in what activities were going on at a site, but I'm also interested in the wider connections of the community that lived at the site with other communities both locally and regionally. Because pottery survives well, no matter what burial conditions, it provides links between sites and advances our understanding of regional and local connections. For my PhD research, I worked on the pottery from the site of Poole and Sandy, one of the northernmost Orkney Islands, where 10,000 sheds of Neolithic pottery were recovered during excavations by Professor John Hunter of Bradford University. The deposits making up the settlement mound at Poole were not mixed. Episodes of sand blow marked breaks in occupation. It was an amazing depositional sequence, which meant that I could construct a detailed ceramic sequence spanning much of the Neolithic. The earliest Neolithic pottery on the site was round-based bowls, an Orkney variant known as Unson bowls, which have a distinct collar, often decorated, and are a common find in chamber tombs. Later in the sequence, there was a major change in the pottery being produced, both in terms of vessel shape and decoration. This pottery is Neolithic grooved ware, the first pottery in Britain to have flat bases, the typical forms being bucket or barrel-shaped vessels, and more tub-shaped open vessels designed to be stable in flat surfaces. Grooved ware is found in most parts of Britain and Ireland in varying quantities, but not in the European mainland. At Poole, because the site was so well stratified, we were able to see two different types of grooved ware in the sequence, an earlier type with incised decoration, which is this one, and a later one, which was full of rock fragments, and it was very different in terms of manufacturing to the earlier grooved ware, with the decoration grooved into a thick slip or stuck on. Unfortunately, at the time of the excavations, it was not possible to date the sequence for the pottery because there was only suitable organic material to provide a few radiocarbon dates. At that point, I was happy to accept that I'd made some advances in the story of Neolithic Orkney by recording the sequence, and that further advances would be for others. But almost 25 years later, a European programme called The Times of Their Lives, led by Professor Alistair Whittle of Cardiff University as the principal investigator and Alex Bayliss of English Heritage as co-director, was established to provide better dating of Neolithic sites across Europe. This included a study of some of the Neolithic sites of Orkney. In the years since I did my PhD research, advances in radiocarbon dating had improved, allowing much smaller samples to be used, including the residues adhering to the interior of pottery sheds, which allowed us to obtain new samples from Poole for radiocarbon dating. Happily, the run of dates for the Times of Their Lives Orkney project resulted in a good sequence for Poole. The dates for the beginning of the production of flat-based incised wares was between 3100 and 3000 BC, and this phase of occupation ended about 2800 BC. After this was a hiatus on the site, a break in settlement, before the resumption of occupation on the site in phase 3, probably dating from around 2600, a settlement which lasted for a few centuries. Being able to place information in a well-dated framework is essential for archaeologists in getting from individual sites to a narrative that joins the sites in an area to build a local and then a regional picture. While we often say it's a Neolithic site, when you think about that statement, it means this site dates from somewhere between 4000 BC and 2500 BC. And this represents a lot of generations. So we want to be able to refine the dating for individual sites and look at what was happening at each of them at different points in the Neolithic. For example, we want to be able to look at what was happening at Nessif Brodgar and Skara Brae and compare it with what was happening on the other islands at the same time, at sites such as Poole and Sandy, and this site, another property in Care, the links of Notland and Westry. For interest, the little figurine is the Westry Wife, also known as the Orkney Venus, discovered during excavations by Hazel Moore and Graham Wilson on behalf of Historic Environment Scotland. Representations of humans are very rare in the Neolithic, so this is a very special find. So back to my big question, where does all this work take us in terms of a narrative for the Neolithic of Orkney, Scotland, and indeed Britain? Looking across Scotland, we can see that the preference for grooved ware in Orkney was not confined to the north of Scotland, but part of a wider development. There are particularly strong links between Scotland and England in terms of assemblages, especially from sites along the east coast, Angus, Fife, Northumberland, Yorkshire, and so on further south. It is recovered from domestic sites and ritual sites such as stone circles and henges, and its period of use spans 3100 to 2200, and the Orkney dates are every bit as early as the dates from the south of England. The recent work on the importance of the dates from Neolithic Orkney has, of course, been given prominence through the BBC's recent archaeology programme, Britain's Ancient Capital, Secrets of Orkney. For me, the interesting thing about the later Neolithic in Britain and Ireland is not which part of the country was the ancient capital, but how it was that in a relatively short period of time, a few centuries, beginning around 3100 BC, we can see a strong sense of community and common culture reflected in pottery use emerging over much of the country. These two pieces of pottery from Radley in Oxfordshire, which is this one here, and Poole up here, the far north and far south of the country, illustrate this well. They indicate a real desire by communities to share this rapidly moving common culture. At any one time, ideas were being exchanged, absorbed, and translated. The patterns seen in pottery are repeated in other artefacts, carved into monuments, and may also have been used in body painting. This commonality indicates that these motifs were symbols imbued with meaning. In the case of pottery choices, local communities being introduced to grooved ware could choose to ignore it, adopt it, or modify it. And many communities chose to adopt it, along with shared styles of houses, ceremonial monuments, and modes of burial, thus creating a shared identity from the north to the south of the country. And all without Twitter. When I was at Bradford University carrying out my research, I thought, like many PhD students, that I would solve the problem, find the answer. But as time has gone on, I've come to like the fact that rather than getting nearer to an answer, the more we find out, the more complex the picture becomes. When we add a piece to the puzzle, it seems that the puzzle expands in all directions, a sign of a vibrant research environment. And I'm sure this is a theme that Kirsty will pick up as I pass over to her.
So Anne finished by talking about that puzzle that expands. Well, when we turn our attention to the first farmers in mainland lowland Scotland, then that puzzle expands even further. In contrast to the stone-built houses and monuments of Orkney, people were largely building from timber. And in many parts of Scotland, this age of stone may actually have been a world more of wood and timber. What this means is that settlement and monuments become much more difficult to find. But when we do identify them, the picture we can build of Neolithic Scotland becomes larger and ever more nuanced. But what this Neolithic wooden world also highlights is something that Anne also mentioned before, is that those age of labels or terms like Neolithic are just that, labels and terms that we place in chronological periods to help us deal with and communicate our evidence. They would have been meaningless to those living within those periods. No one during the Neolithic considered themselves Neolithic, nor would they have been aware when they became Neolithic or changed into Bronze Age. So while those divisions remain helpful for us, we have to bear in mind that they are distinctions that we place on the past. And as I said, when it comes to what we term Neolithic in many parts of Scotland, we've got to consider it a world largely full of wood and timber. So my research is largely focused on the timber monuments, the varied wooden ritual and ceremonial monuments that people built throughout the Neolithic. So I'm going to focus largely on them for the remainder of this talk, though I'll also talk a little bit about the evidence we have for settlement in lowland Scotland. And again, this points to timber-built structures. This doesn't mean that people were not using stone and other materials to build outside of Orkney. Far from it, we find stone monuments such as chamber cairns and stone circles, and earthen monuments such as long barrows across the whole of Scotland. It's just that people were also building things of timber, and in some parts of the country, those timber constructions form a large part of the evidence that we have for the Neolithic period. And in fact, in some parts of the country, there may have been more structures of timber than of stone. In part, this is because during the Neolithic period, large parts of the landscape of Scotland was wooded, so very different from today. And so timber was a readily available resource. It's during the Neolithic period that we see the first substantial modification of this woodland. Trees were cut down to clear areas for farming and to build these wooden monuments and houses. And this was something entirely new and must have created new and very different relationships between people and their surrounding environment. And we think this may at least be partly reflected in the construction of wooden monuments. Wooden monuments and buildings are going to be very difficult to find. After 5,000 years or so, the wood that they were built from will have long gone. So how do we find them when the wood has long since decayed and disappeared? Well, one of the principal methods is through aerial survey and recording crop marks from the air. Essentially, archaeological remains below the ground affect the way in which crops grow up and ripen above the ground, giving height, colour and height differences above buried features. These can be spotted from the air and photographed, and the patterns seen in those crops interpreted as archaeological sites. We base our interpretation of purely crop mark sites on knowledge gained from excavations of similar sites. So, for example, here large post holes, so the holes dug to take large timber posts like those at the top of the screen that have been excavated, so like these ones here, will show as darker marks in crops, and the patterns they make can be interpreted as particular sites and monuments. And in this case, we have an early Neolithic timber cursus, so there's a kind of line of dark blobs here, which are post holes, and a later Neolithic timber enclosure down here, which is this rectangular shape of, again, dark post holes. And I'll talk a little bit about those different types of monuments later on. Now, HES actively undertakes aerial survey each year, recording both crop mark sites as they're revealed and also upstanding archaeology. And as a result, we have a very rich record of crop mark and other sites recorded from the air. This record is available for anyone to search and view the photographs on HES's CanMore database. And most of the evidence that I'll be talking about is drawn from this aerial survey and the information contained in HES's own database. Aerial survey isn't the only way that we find sites. Many are also discovered during development and excavated as part of the planning process. These are often very unexpected discoveries, turning up in places we perhaps wouldn't have expected them. But when sites and monuments discovered through both of these methods are uncovered, it's the ground plans of these monuments, sites and monuments we have to work from. The above ground and upstanding elements tend to have long gone, and we're usually dealing with the foundations and post holes, which can be quite a challenge for our interpretation and understanding of what these represent. And when it comes to settlement evidence, in lowland Scotland, it's largely through development-led excavations that we have most of our evidence. And that evidence tends to be confined to pits and post holes, suggesting that settlement was on the whole relatively light, or at least the evidence it left behind is fairly light. This doesn't mean the settlement itself was unsubstantial or that settlement was temporary, just that the impact of that houses and settlements have made and what they've left behind for us to find is relatively slight and difficult to make sense of. And the houses that we know of at least seem to have been relatively modest. And you can see a couple of examples of plans of what we think are Neolithic houses from lowland Scotland, largely made of patterns of pits and post holes. And on the bottom left is a reconstruction drawing of a site that was excavated in East Lothian. But in the early part of the Neolithic, we also have a small group of very substantial rectangular buildings called timber halls, which some have suggested represent settlement. Some have been recorded as crop marks in aerial photographs, and a number have been excavated. So we've got a good idea of what these may have looked like. The most well-known is the timber hall excavated at Balbridie in Aberdeenshire. On the left, you can see a reconstruction drawing of what Balbridie may have looked like. On the right are ground plans of both excavated and crop mark examples. As you can see from this reconstruction, we usually interpret these structures as substantial roofed buildings. So could these be the kinds of houses that everybody was living in? Well, probably not. We know of only a small number, so although we know our evidence is incomplete, we would expect to see far more in the archaeological record if these were common monument or common settlement sites, the place where people were most commonly living in. So they're relatively unusual. As I said, we do have some settlement evidence from lowland Scotland, but timber halls are much more substantial compared to the rest of the evidence. So they're unusual in that respect too. And the archaeological remains recovered from these sites makes us think that there's something else going on here. The archaeological remains are fairly unusual and suggest that these timber halls may have been more than just domestic sites. So added together, this suggests that these were not normal settlement sites and that something different was going on here. This doesn't mean these sites were not lived in at all, just that they're probably better interpreted as more specialist sites, which were used for specific activities, ranging perhaps from stories to ceremonial gatherings. If we move our attention on to the later Neolithic, one of the most exciting discoveries of the last few years is the identification of a number of late Neolithic timber roundhouses, each with a central setting of four posts within an outer wooden wall of close-set posts. Two such structures were excavated in Aberdeenshire in the 1990s, but were only recently dated and shown to be late Neolithic in date. Another was excavated recently within a large late Neolithic enclosure in Perthshire and also shown to be of Neolithic date. With this dating in place, we were then able to look back at the crop mark record and identify a number of similar structures that had been recorded many years before and assign them to the Neolithic period. This includes what appears to be a remarkable cluster of eight roundhouses at Chapelton and Angus, which you can see on the right of the screen here. And on the bottom left is a reconstruction based on one of the excavated Aberdeenshire examples. Now, this cluster of structures at Chapelton suggests that perhaps this is a village. If it is a village, and we don't know the relative dating of these structures, we don't know if they're all contemporary, then this is likely to be of similar date to Scarabray, and suggests that perhaps clustered settlements are not just a feature of the Northern Isles. We don't have any good evidence for villages in Neolithic lowland Scotland, but perhaps this is the first good evidence of that. But unfortunately, this picture, or fortunately maybe, this picture is complicated by the recent excavation of one further example near Creef in Perth, and also an example uncovered in the 1980s under a stone circle in Arran. Both are large double timber circles with internal four-post settings, very similar to the excavated Aberdeenshire examples and the Chapelton examples, but on a much larger scale, and with an extra outer timber setting. Both, though, have been interpreted as ceremonial timber circles, which weren't roofed. And on the right, you can see this is a half-size reconstruction of the timber circle that was excavated near Creef. And in the bottom left, this is a plan, an excavation plan, of the example excavated under a stone circle, so predating a stone circle on Machree Muir. So what we seem to have is evidence of what looks like houses, on one hand, that people were living in, and then very large, perhaps, structures that we interpret as ceremonial timber circles that we don't think people were living in. But they both look very similar. So how do we make sense of this? Well, this is one of the difficulties and puzzles of our evidence for the Neolithic. It can often be very difficult to distinguish between the places where people were living and those places that had other, perhaps different, specialist or ceremonial purposes. What seems to be the case is similar motifs and constructional forms, such as a square within a circle that we see in these structures, are shared across different kinds of structures, domestic and ceremonial and in between. It's been suggested by Richard Bradley that during the Neolithic, we see the concept of the big house, enlarged versions of houses that had a more specialist purposes, like the timber halls I mentioned, and perhaps like some of the four-post structure roundhouses or timber circles that you can see in the screen here. What I think this also tells us is that there's no clear dividing line between domestic and ceremonial, and the structure that communities in the past may have expressed meanings and identities across the different types of structures that we identify in our record. By far the most numerous evidence for the Neolithic is of monument building. As well as the more familiar stone monuments, such as the chamber cairns and stone circles that Anne talked about earlier, we also have evidence for a number of timber-built monuments. Now, my PhD research looked at the evidence for timber monuments of Neolithic date across Scotland, and I spent a lot of time looking through the aerial photographs of crop marks now held by HES to identify those monuments that are likely of Neolithic date. And I used the information we have from excavations to make sense of the crop mark record, because there are a lot of sites that have been recorded but never excavated. What this research indicates is that monuments built of timber were likely as important to Neolithic communities as those of stone and earth, like stone circles and chambered tombs, so need to play a key part of our evidence for the Neolithic in Scotland. So let me just tell you a little bit about some of those monuments. If we start at the beginning of the Neolithic, the earliest monuments that we know of were roughly rectangular in form, include the timber halls I mentioned earlier. Now I include them in discussions of monuments because, as I said, the evidence suggests there was something more going on at these sites, something more specialised going on at these sites. And also they were at a completely different scale from the rest of the settlement evidence that we know about. But earlier Neolithic monuments also include the monuments shown on the screen here, which are we call timber cursus monuments. These are long, linear monuments which were formed of large timber posts, most in the region of hundreds of metres in length. The longest one that we know of is an example in Angus, which was around about 570 metres long, but some were relatively shorter, closer to 100 metres. So these were massive monuments. And on the screen you can see the ground plans of a number of these timber cursus monuments. Each dot represents a post hole which would have held a large timber post. These posts might have been up to a couple of metres in height, so these would have been very large and very impressive monuments. They also would have needed a lot of timber to build, which meant that a lot of trees must have been cut down to build them. On the right is a reconstruction drawing based on an example excavated at Bannockburn. We usually interpret these as large ceremonial monuments. From the middle of the Neolithic, we begin to see a change in the forms of timber monuments being built. None of the monuments constructed in the earlier part of the Neolithic continue to be built, and instead we see the appearance of curvilinear forms of monument for the first time, along with new forms of rectilinear monuments. This appears to tie in with wider changes within Neolithic communities, also reflected in pottery styles mentioned by Anne, and changes in the settlement evidence that we see. So there seem to be wide changes going on at this period that we can trace, at least in pottery styles, in monuments that were the types of monuments that were being built. Now, these new timber monuments include timber circles, palisaded enclosures, and rectangular timber enclosures. Here on the screen, you can see the ground plans of what I term rectilinear enclosures. Over the years, they've been given a number of different names, but essentially they seem to represent enclosures of space posts, or perhaps as in the reconstruction drawing here, fenced enclosures, which don't appear to have been roofed. Now, the fact that the interpretation that these weren't roof structures comes from the way in which many were laid out, which would have made it very, very difficult to roof a structure. The fact that the Kirsty main site, when that site was excavated, it was found to have possibly surrounded the location of a tree. And in some cases, there's evidence for the placement of some, but not all of the timbers, which would have been difficult if they'd been roofed. So what were these sites for? Well, as in the reconstruction here, it's been suggested that these were places for laying out bodies. That's not impossible, but there's limited evidence for that. Again, we think largely that these were ceremonial monuments of some form, open enclosures in which specific activities took place. In the late Neolithic, also sees the construction of palisaded enclosures here on the left and timber circles on the right. If we look at palisaded enclosures first, these were massive timber enclosures measuring several hundred metres in diameter, all of which include smaller monuments within them. They represent enclosure on a completely different magnitude of scale than what we'd seen before. Now, we know of five definite and one possible example in the archaeological record, so these were not common monuments, which combined with the scale and effort involved in their construction and the fact that they tend to encompass several smaller monuments, I think suggests that these monuments were built by and to encompass larger groups of people. Perhaps they were drawing scattered communities from a wider area, and perhaps they were forming similar kinds of function as the structures Anne mentioned at the Ness of Brodgar, as a focus for large-scale events. Some of these also, these large timber enclosures also enclose timber circles, which we also find as independent monuments in their own right. These are type of monument that don't conform to period boundaries that we set, because we begin to see them in archaeological record in the late Neolithic, and they continue to be built into what we usually define as the early Bronze Age. Again, that's a reminder that those period boundaries are our constructs and not something that would have been recognised by those living at the time. Timber circles themselves are a curious monument and one that very much intrigues me, because there's so much variety in size, context, and the way in which they were used. Some of them predate and are later enclosed within later henge monuments. Others seem to be entirely independent monuments. Others may have been built in association with or as part of a cluster of other monuments. Some are very small, perhaps only around 10 metres or so in diameter. Others are bigger. The two largest that we know of are 48 metres in diameter, and the very largest is around 75 metres in diameter. So I think the fact that there's so much variety within what we term timber circles suggests or indicates that our definition of timber circles actually encompasses a number of different types of monuments. Some, I think, were large ceremonial enclosures. Others, particularly the handful of very small timber circles built during the early Bronze Age, may be mortuary monuments, or at least associated, or at least have had mortuary associations. So the record is quite complex. So those are some of the timber monuments that we see being built during the Neolithic period, and there are some others that I've not mentioned. I hope you can see that the Neolithic landscape would have been populated with wooden monuments alongside the stone and earth monuments that we are much more familiar with. Many of these monuments would have been spectacular and substantial. What were they for? Well, we know of a large variety, so we know they must have had a number of different purposes connected to a variety of activities and beliefs. We know that the monuments that were built changed from during the whole of what we term the Neolithic period. So we know that they must have had a variety of different purposes. Even monuments that we group under the same type, so timber circles, may have had varying purposes and uses. What all the monuments I've talked about have in common is that we tend to interpret these as ceremonial monuments, not as places where people were living. And what also they seem to have in common is all seem to have formed an important focal point or important focal points for Neolithic communities. While we're able to identify monument types built over a wide area, they're not all carbon copies of one another. So not all Kirsty's monuments are the same. Instead, there is distinct variety even within the same type. And I think we're able to see local expressions of belief or ideas around a theme, value, or set of ideas in the individual monument types. Communities were using the same basic idea or form, but using to express individual identity or purpose within their particular setting. So as an example, I'm involved in a small research project in Dumfries and Galloway, the Loughborough Landscape Project. Part of that has involved investigating a timber Kirsty's monument using non-destructive survey methods. Our research there suggests that the Kirsty's was very closely tied to its landscape setting, and that details of its form that we see was likely influenced by the very distinctive natural topography at Loughborough. We can also suggest that the natural setting may have been used to create different levels of access. So although the Loughborough Kirsty's was built along the same lines as timber Kirsty's monuments we see elsewhere, in its general form, the specific details of its layout, so the specific nature of the form of the monument, and the way in which it could have been approached and used was influenced by the choice of physical location. And in turn, that choice will reflect the local beliefs and ideals of the communities who built it. And we see different relationships at other Kirsty's monuments. So the monuments that were built and how they were used were also tied to the context in which they were built. And we see varied expressions of monumentality around a theme. That's probably the same for house structures as well. But we're discovering new sites all the time, something which has the potential to transform and change our picture of the Neolithic period in Scotland. As Anne said, even a place as well known as Orkney, new and unexpected things continue to turn up. That's even more likely when dealing with timber-built structures in Scotland, or in lowland Scotland. One of the aspects that makes studying this period exciting is that there's always more to be discovered. There's always something more out there to be found. And that new thing to be found, that new discovery, may make you rethink what you thought you knew about the sites and monuments and the people who built, used and lived within them. But what we do know is that throughout the Neolithic period, people were building sophisticated structures and enclosures of wood and stone, living in houses, clearing land for farming, and essentially beginning to transform their landscape and surroundings in new ways. Some of those new relationships may have been negotiated through the construction of wooden monuments, or at least reflected in the choice to construct large wooden monuments and the transformation of space and place in new ways. But people didn't continue to do exactly the same thing throughout what we traditionally consider the Neolithic. This is a period of innovation and change, something we trace through changes in the monuments people built, the houses they lived in, the tools they made, and the pottery styles they employed. This is more than just an age of stone. It was an age of transformation, development, and new ideas laid the foundation for all that came after. And if anything we've talked about is of interest, there are a number of different ways to get involved. I mentioned the Canmore database, which is HES's online catalogue to Scotland's historic environment. It's a good place to start, where I have based a lot of my research and a lot of what I've talked about. As has been mentioned, HES will be also running a number of activities for the Year of Heritage History and Archaeology. More widely, beyond ourselves, the Society of Antiquaries of Scotland runs a lecture series throughout the year and is also running Dig It 2017, a year-long celebration of Scotland's archaeology with lots of activities planned. Archaeology Scotland is also a good organisation if you want to get involved in archaeology, and there's more information on all of their websites. And both Anne and I have mentioned a couple of projects that we're involved in. If you're interested in finding out more, that we've both got websites, or both the projects have got websites, and the web addresses are on the screen there. So it just remains for me to thank you for listening, and I think Anne and I would be happy to answer any questions if anybody has any.